To start TouchDesigner, we'll just find it on the desktop and start it up. And what you're being faced with once it started is pretty much an empty canvas, looking like this. So you have a very minimal and arguably not the nicest sample network here. We decided here on some jelly beans that are being displaced. But it kind of gives an idea of how networks look like in TouchDesigner. I just gotta turn off these notifications, but I don't know how. So the general interface that you see here, we would talk in the center of it, you have your network pane, your network editor. I use these terms probably interchangeably. Can't really decide on a word there. On the upper right of the network editor is parameters. And parameters are for every node, there's a separate set of parameters. So you can click on a node to select it, and you see that you get the green outline on a selected node, and the parameter window changes with you selecting different nodes. Now sometimes, and that's important to remember, sometimes the parameters are hidden, and if the parameters are hidden, just if you hit P, the P key, that toggles the parameters. What Touch also shows you, or the interface shows you, is these wires here, things connecting into other things. And some of these wires are animated. So you see that this wire here, the first one, from a node that's called movie file in to the displays, it's static. And that's because it's just an image and there's nothing happening with this image. So there's no data flow. Down here, that's a different operator, a chop2 top, which I'll come to later. And I'll also talk about these acronyms in a bit. And you see that this is a moving image, so there's data that's being calculated all the time, and therefore this wire is actually animating. And if you look closely, you can see that this wire is animating from left to right. Left to right is also the general direction that these networks work. You start data on the left side, and everything you add on the right side, data moves down that stream. There's another type of connector here. I'll get to that in a second. And then you have, in the center, you have this operator called geo1. And this doesn't have a frame currently. Now, if you see nodes that don't have these frames, what that means is that the viewer is interactive. So each node comes with its own viewer. You can see here an image, here an animated image, and then here you have something that looks like a 3D object. And this viewer is actually an interactive 3D viewer. So if you click with your mouse in it, and then you can rotate or toggle the whole thing, tumble the whole thing with your left mouse button, your middle mouse button will dolly around in this 3D sphere, and your right mouse button will pan. If you see nothing in here, move your mouse into the viewer and hit H, and it homes the view. H is generally the home shortcut. It's the same for networks. If I have my mouse on an empty part of the network and hit H, it homes to the whole network that's currently in your network viewer. The other thing with Touch is that the interface is a little bit like a GUI kind of thing. You can, with the left mouse button, pan around it. Again, with the scroll wheel of your mouse, you can zoom. And with the right mouse button, you window select if you need to select multiple nodes, or also just one node, then that's your right mouse button. So there is an important thing about this zooming thing. You can use the scroll wheel for it, or you use the third mouse button. Sometimes it's the scroll wheel as well. If you click it, then you have a endless zoom. If you use the scroll wheel for scrolling around or zooming around in the network, what eventually happens is that it zooms out of that network and you end up in a totally different space with different nodes. And that shows a little bit that TouchDesigner is organized, or projects in TouchDesigner are organized in such a way that you have, so to say, folders like on your file system, and inside these folders you can put more operators, and inside those, if you zoom in, there's even more. So it's a little bit of an endless system. So if you find yourself suddenly in a different spot, usually that means that you zoomed out or into a network. And how do you know that you switched from one network into another? We do have on the top here, there's a little address bar. So here it says /project1/. So it's a standard folder notation as well. And now if I scroll wheel out of this network, you see that now I'm at slash, I'm at the root of the whole thing. This node that I see then here is called project one. And if I go inside it, you can see project one up here. There's basic navigation in here as well. Like you can click on the root slash and navigate all children of root, etc. Yeah, if you want to use keys for this, there is the U key for up. So up would take you to the root. And then there's I for inside. And this would take you inside the component, and these folders, they're called components, that is selected. So currently you can see that I have a node here, which is called the displays, which is selected. And if I hit I cannot go inside it because it's not a component itself, it's an operator. While the GO1 here is actually a component, so if I highlight it, and I highlight it here because it doesn't have a frame currently, I highlight it with the right mouse window selected, and I hit I go inside of it. U outside again. Now what I wanted to say is that when you have these nodes without frames, there's this little flag down here, which is called the viewer active flag. And all nodes have that in common. You see that here in the bottom right corner. And if you hit that flag, either it hides the frame or it activates the viewer to become this interactive viewer. As I said, the GO1 is a 3D viewer. So you have 3D controls. But what about textures? For textures, 3D controls wouldn't necessarily make sense. You can still zoom with the middle mouse button and really inspect your pixels here if you need to. H can always home it. Otherwise, you have the options by right-clicking into it to switch between the different channels in your texture, the different color channels, or have a field guide or see the pixel values actually. Likewise, when you right-click on those, you see the shortcut keys on the right side. So R is for the red channel. If you hit R again, it goes back to all four channels combined. Some more words to the parameters. What's important about the parameters is that you can get help from them. There's lots and lots of parameters for each node, mostly because if you have worked in other node-based software, let's say MaxMSP, V4, or most of those, every node has usually a very specific function to it. You have a node that adds two numbers. in TouchDesigner, we group those functions into one operator. So if you want to add two numbers together, you would use something that's called a math chop, but this math chop can not just add values, it can also give you the average or negate all numbers or make them all positive. And so those parameters can get fairly extensive because each node has so many options to it. And to see what a node does and what it's capable of, there is the help button up here, which takes you to our wiki. And here you see the general explanation of the node, and then for each parameter, a little description of what the node does, of what the parameter does. Right beside it is something that's called Python help. Now, Touch uses as an internal scripting language Python. So all these nodes are generally can be considered as Python objects with their own members and their own methods. So if you want to find out what these members and methods are, then click the Python help, which again takes you to the wiki. And there you get all the methods and the inherited methods and with a couple examples as well. Next comes an info flag. We'll get to that eventually. And then on the other side, we have tags, not necessarily something we will talk about. We have comments, if you want to leave comments with the nodes. It's not the best commenting system. So if you click on it, a little text field pops up right underneath where you can leave a comment. And then you see that there's a little speech bubble on the node, which tells you that there's actually a comment on the node. Copied values, that's not necessarily something. This is an important one, language. We started in TouchDesigner 88 to have Python as a scripting language. And before that, TouchDesigner used something that was called TScript. Now, TScript was directly inherited from Houdini and is a much more Unix-like scripting language, but very limited. So it's still there. And sometimes you will come across examples from people that are using TScript. If you try to use Python then in those nodes, then nothing works because the node is running in TScript. So it's always good to watch out if something weird happens, something doesn't work the way you want. If you're using scripting, then check this button up here. And last but not least, and which is fairly important too, there is the expand parameters, which kind of gives you a way too big view of all the parameters. So if your parameters look like this, you can always collapse them again. And after that, there's a flag called non-default parameters. So if you click this flag, then the parameters collapse down to only the parameters that are not default. This can be really helpful if you're trying to understand what a network is doing and you want to see what people changed, then click this flag and it will show you only the non-defaults. So if I set this to the translate to one of this geo and click that, now I see I have the translate and the material in here. But again, if you come across parameters and you don't see the parameters that you expect to see, usually it's the case because this flag is toggled.
Do you have a way to, let's say you start messing with parameters, and to default back to 0 or 1?
Yeah. Sure. If you right click onto a parameter name, for example, then there's a little parameter pop-up menu, and down at the close to the bottom, there's a reset parameter, which resets the parameter to its default. I think you also have access per on a per parameter basis, like because this translate here, translate in X, Y, Z, because the geometry, if I change X and Y here, and I just want to reset the X value, you can also just click into the first field, and reset parameter will just reset the first one. Okay. Right below the parameters, or right below the network viewer, we have the timeline. Something that often happens is that the timeline is not running. And this will cause confusion, because then if the timeline is not running, some stuff is not evaluated and stuff doesn't move. And often the keyboard shortcut for this is the space bar. So it's something that happens, you're typing something and hit space accidentally. It's always good to check if you're playing forward. You have default controls here. It's not, I mean, I hardly use the timeline, any of those controls. You just leave it playing, and that's, in most cases, that's enough to do. Sometimes you need to change the length of the timeline if you have time-based animations or such. And you can do this in the left lower corner here, where you have a start end. So if I want to make my timeline 6,000 frames long, just type this into the end parameter here. And then you have the range controls right after below. But you can also use the range bar itself to set the range that you want to be looping over. It's for our purpose, we'll just say it's for the whole project, despite the fact that if you need it, you can have multiple timelines. But in general, I would just think about it as that's for the whole project. Yeah. The other thing shown here is your frames per second. This is the speed at which Touch is rendering or tries to render your or calculate your whole project. So it runs at 60 frames per second by default. And right beside it is the tempo, which is the beat per minute. If you're running an audio visualizer or if you're running something to music, then you might be using beat-based interactions, and then the tempo becomes important. And I'll show you how to set the tempo later on. So that's the timeline down here. On the left side of the network editor, you have what we call the palette. And the palette is a collection of things that we think people might find useful. So if you would want to, let's see, there's some tools in there and image filters as well. So let's say you want to pixelate your image, then if you go to image filter and find the pixelate component, you can just take that and drag it into your network. And you have something that pixelates the image with a couple of custom parameters here, where you have control over the effect. Now, all these components in the palette, they're just networks. So you can go inside and see how they're made. It's a good learning resource. It's not necessarily always the most complete set of functionality in these. I just want to mention that, for example, there's the under tools, there's a GPU, or what is it called, particle GPU component, which is a particle system that's computed on the GPU. It has lots of functionality, but there is a good chance that it doesn't have all the functionality what you might expect from a particle system. It's a little bit complex, but later on you'll be able to manipulate those. There's nothing hidden in there. It's all just pre-made components with the default touch operators. Further down, there is a little My Components section. And in the My Components section, you can add a folder for yourself. And then what you can do is you can take components such as the GO1, which might encapsulate functionality that you want to use somewhere else. And you just drag this component onto the palette, and it creates a new palette entry that you now have accessible in all your projects. So it's something where you can collect things you might need later on. Okay, last but not least, we'll look at the top here. Oh, that's not last, actually. The top menu bar, that's just the default menus. There's lots of dialogues we might dive into, we might not. Then some shortcuts that take you directly to the wiki, to the forum on the web, and some tutorials that we've been collecting from us and other users as well, video tutorials, text tutorials, etc. Right beside it is a very important button, that's the cooking button. If you turn that off, Touch basically doesn't do anything anymore. It just stops calculating anything. This button comes in very useful if your project goes down to doesn't perform at all anymore. You did something that totally shuts down Touch, then trying to click this button might give you back control because it stops calculating stuff. Now you can go and see what's happening. But generally, you want to keep this on. And then beside it is this little FPS display here, which gives you information on how what the actual speed is that Touch can achieve, that Touch renders at. Since if you're doing things and they get too heavy, then certainly you will not reach the 60 frames per second, and this gives you an idea of how fast your how fast Touch is actually rendering those images. Right beside it is the real-time flag. The real-time flag can be interesting if you're if you don't want to display results real-time at 60 frames per second. You just want to really see every single frame. Then turning off real-time will make sure that every single frame gets rendered. There's no skipped frames. It always renders every frame. It might just render 30 frames per second, but it's definitely renders every one. And then you have a little status message here, which gives you, just shows if you delete a note or something like that, it gives you a little info. And beside that is something, if this turns yellow or green, it's just an alerting, us alerting you that there's a new version that you can install. If it's yellow, then it's an experimental release, and if it's green, then it's an official release. We do release software every 2 weeks in that cycle. We switched our concept. Previously, we went Touch 77, then Touch 88, and now Touch 99. We'll not be increasing version numbers like that anymore. It's just going to be Touch 99, and we just put out features as they come. So we always advise to update, and if it's not for a show, we always recommend the official releases. If you just want to experiment and see what's new, then the experimental releases are perfectly fine. Okay, so let's have a look at the different operator types. We already can see here three different ones. We have these slight purple operators, which hold image data. So you see an image in here. Pixels, basically. Colored pixels. And these are called TOPS. That stands for texture operators. Now, further below, down here, we have a channel. So it's animation data. It can be audio. It can be the values that come in from other devices that you have connected, like a Wife controller or an Arduino or whatever. And those are called CHOPs. That stands for channel operators, and they're always green. The view here, and we'll see this when I talk more about CHOPs, can be either a graph, if it's a multi-sample channel, or it can be a bar, if it's just one value. And then here we have that which is called components, which are, generally speaking, those are containers where you put more nodes inside. For our purpose now, let's just delete it all. So to select all the nodes, you can hit Control, or I guess that's Apple A, I think.
Command A?
Command.
To select all?
It's Control on Windows. I'm very much not Command. Yeah, okay, Command. Which selects all the nodes, and then delete will just delete the whole thing.